the conversation about Phil Ochs going on online is reverberating about now, because this whole week things are going on. You want me to read this to you? Story from Phil, about Phil from Herbie Andrews. This was on the other side of the pond. Because I know how transport, still a sought after thing on the folk scene at the time, an opportunity was offered to me that I couldn't possibly refuse. Lone Allen told me that Phil Ochs was appearing in concert, I think in Nottingham, and that he had a couple of days free afterwards at that hotel, and finance problems meant that he had nowhere to stay. I think that's John Tran.
So.
What? Would I like to drive over, pick him up, and bring him back to my flat to stay? Would I? Sure I would. Seeing Phil on stage was a revelation. He had some new songs that instantly appealed to me, and meeting him backstage after the gig was an unforgettable moment. That night, back at my bedsit, Phil and I talked into the early hours. We shared a love of Buddy Holly and played a few old singles. We discussed the folk scene and eventually got on to Bob Dylan, whose songs were all the rage on the politically active left. Phil mentioned that some people would happily kill Dylan, and we talked about the repercussions about his assassination. I said it would be like the crucifixion of Christ to many and would give the movement a martyr. Something all causes need as a rallying point. Eventually, he slept in my bed and I slept on the floor in my living room. In the morning, I got my tape recorder running and persuaded Phil to record three new songs for me, Flower Lady, Canons of Christianity, and Santo Domingo. Two ends or one, he asked before singing Canons of Christianity, and apologizing for his voice, it's hard singing in the morning. After performing the songs, he went through them again to give me the chords. Within a week, the songs were added to my repertoire. In the afternoon, I took him to my mother's, where he was fed a huge plateful of meat and two vegetables, followed by a cannonball of fruit pudding covered in custard. He was very appreciative. Mother had no idea who he was, but admired his old-fashioned manners and his courtesy towards her. Unfortunately, he lost a contact lens in the front room, even though he had a towel spread over his lap while he was cleaning it. He sat unmoving as Mother and I carefully examined every inch of him, the settee he was sitting on, and the carpet on the floor, all without success. Eventually, he got up and Mother vacuumed the room and then dissected the contents of his bag. We never found the lens, and it could be lying somewhere in 85 Kenilworth Road to this day. Phil being Phil, had no replacement, and so he had a wire to America for a replacement to be sent out to. It was in England, according to his biography by Michael Schumacher. This one, there, but for fortune.
It's the one that the family likes.
Yes, it's the one that the family likes.
Yeah.
Yes, that Phil began to write his epic, Crucifixion. As he stayed with me on the 24th of November, and if the book is correct, began the song on the night of the 27th, I am convinced our conversation on the night of the 24th had a lot to do with his inspiration. Before he left, he signed my visitor's book, Phil Ochs, Hanoi. And that was Phil. Yeah, so that's a crucifixion story.
That's great.
That's great. I get to introduce somebody now that I'm not going to say anything about her voice. You're going to tell me who it sounds like. So, ladies and gentlemen, without any further delay, let me introduce to the stage someone who I get to introduce now and again, and I always enjoy what happens after. Ann Price.
Phil Ochs live once. I don't remember what year it was. I know it was in Manhattan somewhere. I don't remember what hall. Only thing I remember about it is that Judy Collins was in the audience, and so was Theodore Bacall. And I very shyly went up to both of them and asked for their autographs. And later I was embarrassed. Why did I bother these people? Anyway.
People have asked you for your autograph.
Yeah, well.
They have. I've seen it.
But I was impressed with how many folk singers were influenced by him, how important he was to the folk singers. So this is one I learned first heard from Joan Baez, of course. And I got used to people telling me, oh, you sound just like her. Show me the prison. Show me the jail. Show me the prisoner whose life has gone stale. And I'll show you a young man with so many reasons why. There but for fortune go you or I, you or I. Show me the show me the train. Show me the hobo who sleeps out in the rain. And I'll show you a young man with so many reasons why. There but for fortune go you or I, you or I. Show me the whiskey. Show me the drunkard as he stumbles out the door. And I'll show you a young man with so many reasons why. Show me the country where the bombs had to fall. Show me the ruins of the building once so tall. And I'll show you a young with so many reasons why. There but for fortune go you or I, you or I. Write this, but he did record it. It's on one of his albums. It was was written by you and McCall. You may you and McCall is one of the most wonderful labor songwriters from England, with Peggy Seeger for many years. And I have a personal story about this. I sang this when I was in college. We used to have something called the Hunter Hootenanny. It was at Hunter College, 19 years old, 1965, 66. And someone made live recordings of those concerts that we did back then, and I rediscovered them through the wonder of the internet, through a friend of a friend. And so I got to hear what I sounded like at 19. And I sounded so good, I went into the studio and edited it, and actually I have a CD of those. Wow. My voice is a lot higher than I did. This is one of the songs that I did.
Same key? Did you sing in the same key that you do now?
No, much lower.
Jesus was a working man, and a hero you shall hear. Born in the slums of Bethlehem, turning of the year, the turning of the year. When he was just a little lad, the streets rang with his name, for he argued with the aldermen, put them all to shame. He put them all to shame. His father he apprenticed him, a carpenter to be, to plane and drill, work with skill. In the town of Galilee, the town of Galilee. He became a roving journeyman, and he traveled far and wide, and he saw that wealth and poverty lived always side by side. Lived always side by side. So the fishermen sent to delegates, and the farmers and the weavers too. And they formed a working committee of 12 to see the struggle through. To see the struggle through. When the rich men heard what the carpenter had done, to the Roman troops they ran, saying, put this rebel Jesus down. He's a menace to God and man, a menace to God and man. The commander of the occupying troops, he laughed and then he said, there's a cross to spare on Calvary Hill. By the weekend he'll be dead. By the weekend he'll be dead. Now Jesus walked among the poor, for the poor were his own kind. And they wouldn't let the cops get near enough to take him from behind. To take him from behind. So they hired a man of the traitor's trade, and a stool pigeon was he. And he sold his brother to the butcher's man for a fistful of silver money, a fistful of money. Jesus sat in the prison cell. They beat him and they offered him bribes to desert the cause sweat stood out upon his brow, and the blood was in his eye, and they nailed his body to the Roman cross, and they laughed as they watched him die. They laughed as they watched him die. 2,000 years have passed and gone, and many a hero too. But the dream of this poor carpenter is up to me and you. Now it's up to me and you.
Something here, right? And there'll be a time when we have a break in the middle of this hootenanny, which I'd like to do here sometime in the future, but this is a good beginning for that. So during the break, Anne has CDs, David has product maybe, but if you lose any of that, contact me at saintfreedom.org or joellandy@yahoo.com, and I'll set you up and connect you. It's all about connecting, right? I do this at the New England Folk Festival for the past 15 years or so. A number of times I've been invited to do a Phil Ochs session, and when I do, it's a lot like this. And before I go there, I email Sonny Ochs and ask him, do you have anything for me to say to the folks who I'll see over the weekend? And I did that the other day, and she wrote me back, and she wrote this. Hello, everyone. First, I'd like to say thank you for taking the time to remember Phil. Second, I cannot believe how many events are taking place this weekend honoring Phil's 75th birthday. It's rather amazing. Last year, Disappear Fear put out an entire CD of Phil's songs. This coming weekend, a young Canadian woman named Erin Suarez Adair will be releasing her All Phil CD in Ottawa. It seems that more and more young people are discovering Phil's songs. The sad thing is, so many of these songs are still relevant. The happy thing is that they are there for us to sing and enjoy and use for our political events. I hope that any of you who play guitar and sing will continue to sing Phil's songs and spread them to new folks who haven't yet heard them. Thanks again for being at this concert. Sonny. Thank you, Sonny. Thank you, Sonny. Yeah, this is one of those songs that don't get old. In the state of Mississippi, many years ago, a boy of 14 years got a taste of Southern love. He saw his friend a-hangin', his color was his crime, and the blood stain on his jacket left a brand upon his mind. Too many martyrs and too many dead, too many lies, words were said too many times, too many angry men. Oh, let it never be again. His name was Medgar Evers. He walked his road alone, like Emmett Till and thousands more whose names we'll never know. They tried to burn his home and they beat him to the ground. But deep inside they both knew what it took to bring him down. Too many martyrs and too many dead, too many lies, too many empty words were said, too many just stepped out of his car into the rifle sight. He slowly squeezed the trigger and a bullet left his side. It struck the heart of every man and never fell to die.
Too many martyrs and too many dead. Too many lives, too many empty words were said.
Too many times. When the bugle sounded clear, they laid him in his grave. When the victory was near, as he dreamed about the future, and he threw out the land. Our nation gained a killer, and our country lost a man. And in the state of Florida, just the other day, Trayvon Martin looked the part and he was blown away. His killer was allowed to walk. His country stood its ground with profile justice, racist rules, and too many guns around. Too many murderers, too many dead, too many lies, too many empty words were said, too many times. Too many angry men, oh, let it never be again. Let it never be again.
Your youth can spoil.
Say, oh,
farmer will take care of you. In the appreciate embraces, sweet shakes that could be made, they will take it. And forget your crooked collar.
When I'm gone.